All right, we're getting ready for UFC 91, and Mark Bocek is here with us. We're out at the MGM just a couple of days before the big fight card. How are you?
Doing good.
All right. Low key. So here's the challenge. We are going to get Mark to open up, I think. We got some cool stuff to get into. I was talking to you before the interview. You know, your fight career has taken off here. You're in the UFC. We want to break down some of the fights, but you have like a really unique tie to UFC from years ago. Which I don't know that has been, you know, told an awful lot. You've actually rolled in the past with guys like Lorenzo Fertitta and Dana White, the owners of UFC. At the time, I don't know that you really knew what was going on because you were like 18 years old, but yeah. It's pretty interesting.
Yeah, you know, I was around 18 and I was up here training in Vegas. I was a purple belt in jiu-jitsu and I was training with John Lewis. And a couple of his students were the Fertittas and Dana. You know, this was around 2000, before Dana was the president of the UFC. And, you know, when he would train them, you know, it was three or four of them at once. So, you know, he kind of needed a little help, got to show techniques on, or, you know, help someone to roll with them and stuff. I was a purple belt at the time, so he just kind of brought me along. I just tagged along, and that's how I met them. And then a year or two later, he was president of the UFC.
Good connection, right? Yeah. Want to put that on the resume? That's not bad. Although it sounded like you submitted him a lot, so I don't know if that was really a resume builder. He made a comment, I think, to one of the reporters that literally you would submit him like every 13 seconds.
Yeah, it could have been like that, you know, but...
Don't be shy. You probably did destroy him. It's not a big deal. Yeah. He's not a fighter.
Yeah, it's true. He was a beginner at the time, but, you know, yeah. I was a purple belt. I had a lot of experience.
So your record's 5-2, but really when you include Lorenzo and Dana in there, it's probably like 95-2.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
How were they? Because you know what I actually hear? I don't know how much work Dana does anymore, but I actually hear that Lorenzo Fertitta, if you see the guy, first of all, I'm not going to mention his height because he's a little shorter than me, but he looks like he weighs about 250 pounds, and I heard he kicks like a mule. So I don't know if he was good at jiu-jitsu, but I know he's the one billionaire you don't want to fight.
Yeah, I haven't seen him recently, so yeah. I can't really say. But, you know, all of them, Frank, Lorenzo, Dana, they're all really cool to me always.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, and it leads to the fact that they run the company well. They're also gigantic fans, and they actually kind of know about the sport because they, you know, unlike maybe Donald Trump, I don't think Trump's going to be rolling with anybody anytime soon, but they get the sport because they get what it takes.
Yeah, you'll never see that happen. They're right in there. They're fans, but, you know, they train too. Goldberg trains, you know, Rogan. They all work out. They all train. They all love it.
Clearly I do with this physique. Not really, no. All right, so that connection goes way back, which is kind of cool because it tells you how long Mark has been working on jiu-jitsu. You were mentioning, what, since like 14 years old, you were a purple belt basically at 18, and you got a black belt when?
I got my black belt in December 2003.
All right.
Started when I was around 14.
There's been a lot of discussion amongst fighters because you hear often that this guy's a black belt, that guy's a black belt, and I've heard people say, well, you know, did he get his black belt in where, Indiana? I mean, does it matter? I mean, you work now at American Top Team. Supposedly there are tons of black belts down there. Have you come in contact with people where it's like, oh, this guy's a certain belt, and then you're like, who decides, you know, at certain gyms? I mean, how do you know it's legit and not legit?
Well, it's everywhere. You know, you have world-class black belts like the ones in Brazil that actually win tournaments,
yeah.
And then you have, say, average ones, say, in North America that, you know, need to open schools or bring people down for seminars, so they need to get students in there. You know, but you can tell really, really quick how good they are.
Yeah.
You know, at ATT, they're all legit, though,
right.
For sure.
And I got
my black belt in Brazil, so I know what it's like to train with the top guys. Like, you can have a blue belt, which is the first belt in jiu-jitsu, a world champion there,
yeah.
You know, beat, you know, the average black belt in the States, no problem.
You know? Yeah. Have you encountered, especially recently, like at American Top Team, cases where you're like, man, I'm just not at this level yet? Or, you know, I don't want you to sit here and brag because I don't know if you're going to, but how do you compare to, you know, other guys that say they're black belts?
I feel confident with all the black belts,
yeah.
You know, everywhere I've trained. They have a great crew, though, at ATT. There's so many, and they're not just black belts. They're professional fighters as
right.
well. But Marcelo Garcia also trains there. And he's yeah. by far the best guy I've ever trained with,
yeah.
ever. I trained with him before I went to ATT while he was still in New York, but his jiu-jitsu is ridiculous.
And we should say, they're, like you said, competing and then going into a cage and practicing jiu-jitsu is a lot different, you know, than just rolling around on the mat and teaching people. It takes something special. So how do you know who is going to be a really effective guy as a high-level jiu-jitsu guy versus some others who, you know, does it come down to heart? Is there certain techniques?
Sometimes it's hard to say. You know, you can gauge a guy from training, but you never really know till they get in there. One thing is a jiu-jitsu tournament. Another thing is getting into a cage and fighting.
Right.
Sometimes it's hard to say, but from training with the guy, you can get a pretty good gauge if he's mentally ready.
Right. Well, to me, the biggest thing in trying to break down fights and assess how good guys are, you still have to get someone to the ground. And we've seen, especially the new breed of, let's say, 185 with the Brazilians who are coming over, some of them, hands-wise, can't really set anything up because their hands aren't that good, and then all of a sudden they go against a good wrestler and they can't take him down. So, I mean, that's a big difference maker. If you can't get someone to the mat, like a good example, I don't know how much you know about Damian Maia against Nate Quarry. I mean, the question is, can Maia get him to the feet and avoid strikes, get him to the ground and avoid strikes on the feet? So that's always kind of a question going in.
Yeah, that's a really good fight. I think they're both great fighters. I'm a big fan of Damian's jiu-jitsu. He's a really high-level jiu-jitsu guy.
Right.
You know, he's a good wrestler, too. Corey's going to try and keep it up. Damian's going to try and take him down. I think it'll be a really good fight.
All right. Now, your fight, you're going against Alvin Robinson. Alvin has been submitted, I thought, pretty easily in two of his fights. And, you know, it was against Kenny Florian. It was against Nate Diaz. They're pretty high-level submission guys. I don't know if they're, you know, at the same level as you. Yet, he talks about having a black belt. And that's what this is where I'm talking about. You know, Mark's a black belt. Alvin's a black belt. Kind of going in, what are your thoughts when a guy's like, oh, I should have no problems with Bocek if we go to the ground?
Well, I look at it like this. Jiu-jitsu's his base, and jiu-jitsu's my base. But on paper, he hasn't really accomplished anything in jiu-jitsu. He's never won any tournaments. You know, I've been competing since I was 14. I've medaled at Pan Ams. I've won a world championship. You know, he knows inside, if it goes to the ground, I'm better at jiu-jitsu. You know, that's just how it is.
Okay, now the flip side of that, in watching your fights, you are a warrior, and you will stand. How tough is it sometimes to not get, suckered into a fight that maybe isn't your best approach? You can strike, but I've seen you really throw with people, and maybe that wasn't the best approach. So when you get in there, is it a matter of experience, or you just kind of lose it sometimes, where all of a sudden you're fighting the fight that you didn't want to fight?
Yeah, experience is huge, but you don't want to get caught up with your emotions too much.
Yeah.
Basically, you gotta have a game plan, but sometimes the hard thing is sticking to the game plan.
Yeah.
But if you can do that, you should be okay.
Your thoughts after some of your fights? Have you always stuck to the game plan?
Most of the time.
Yeah.
Most of the time. In my last fight, I wish I wouldn't have tried to take him down so much.
Okay.
You know, I felt like I was doing good with the striking. I felt I was beating him to the punches, even in the first round. And then, taking him kind of down was unnecessary.
Right.
So I wish I could have changed that, but I'm sure I'll get a chance to in the future.
All right, before we get out of here, I want to get your preview of Lesnar and Couture, the main event. There's a lot of questions here. I mean, you're smiling. It really is a cool fight to break down. You got experience against massive size, and he's got a good wrestling background. For me, a lot of the fight is going to come down to maybe 2 or 3 minutes in. Well, all of a sudden, you know, it's not easy this time. Lesnar isn't throwing someone around like a rag doll. Is that what the fight comes down to for you, or is it going to be is the physical thing the big thing, where Randy's the one who has the challenge to overcome the 285 pounds and the maybe the 50-pound weight advantage?
I think it's a tough fight for both guys.
Yeah.
You know, Randy's a wrestler. Brock's a bigger, stronger wrestler who's not going to get tired. I think it's a really interesting fight. He's, you know, youth, experience. It's kind of hard to say. It's a pick'em fight, you know.
Yeah.
It could go either way. It's hard to say. I'm gonna looking forward to that one though.
No selection.
Hard to say.
You know, that was good. We got him to open up, and now come on, be a prognosticator. Really? You don't think you can make a pick?
I mean, if I had to choose, I guess I'll say Brandy, because anytime I bet against him, he won. So I'll say Randy, but I think it'll be an interesting fight.
I saw the hesitation there, though, because he was like, if I have to choose, it's going to be Randy. You're kind of caught in between.
Yeah, it's hard to say. I don't know. It's not a fight I'd put money on.
All right. Good luck in this fight, and we're looking forward to it.
All right. Thanks a lot.